To be able to understand what these researchers were doing in their experiments, we have to look at what is actually the molecular basis of making cells look different. And if you recall, in the central dogma of molecular biology, basically we have this forward-flowing transition of information, where we start with DNA, that's somewhat the template, and then DNA is transcribed to RNA, and then RNA is translated to protein. And it turns out that cell differences are primarily attributed to what different genes are being expressed in what different cells. So the only difference between a neuron and a red blood cell, even though they have identical genomes, is that different genes are being expressed in each cell. So to be able to understand what makes cells look different, we should be able to quantify what genes are being expressed. The end goal for quantifying gene expression is to generate a gene expression matrix, where basically each row represents a gene, and each column represents a checkpoint or an experiment. And each cell, IJ, represents the expression of gene I at experiment or checkpoint J. Instead of taking the raw gene expression values, though, we typically want to take the log base 2 of those expression values just to give it a bit more of a spread over the number spectrum. So a gene expression matrix, basically you have all of your different samples, which are all the different columns, and you have each gene, which is a different row, and you can basically plot the trajectory of your gene's expression as a function of whatever experiment you're doing. So each row of a gene expression matrix is basically the collection of all gene expression values for that gene across all the experiments. We can then plot the gene expression vector and basically show the trajectory of the expression of this gene as a function of whatever characteristic we're studying in our experiments. And then this gene expression vector, it's just one row of the gene expression matrix. We can then take all of our gene expression matrix and then create what's called a heat map to make it a little bit easier to be able to visualize what genes are up or down regulated, in other words, have high or low expression as a function of the different experimental conditions. So a gene expression heat map is basically the same thing as the gene expression matrix, except instead of numerical values, we're color coding the expression values. So in this plot, red shows high expression and blue shows low expression. Another way to think about your gene expression matrix is that you have this n by m matrix where each of your n rows corresponds to a single point, and you have m columns representing m dimensions. So each gene is one point in m-dimensional space. And then this way, what we can see is basically we should be trying to find out how these genes cluster in this m-dimensional space. So formally, we're going to define this as a computational problem. The good clustering principle, just informally first, is that elements within the same cluster should be relatively closer together than elements in different clusters. So, in other words, the distance between elements within the same cluster should be below some arbitrary threshold, and the distance between elements in different clusters should be above the same corresponding threshold. And as you can see, in this example, this is probably a bad clustering, because we have some elements in this top set of points that are extremely far apart but are in the same cluster, where in reality we'd probably want to make three different clusters in this example, like this. Now we have, within each cluster, fairly small pairwise distances between elements, and across clusters, we have fairly large pairwise distances.